Welcome to How to Make a Gantt Chart in Excel, Part 4. This video will show how to change the color of the bars in the Gantt chart by choosing a color or using a formula to assign a color based on the lead name. I'll also show how to highlight overdue tasks. This video includes some advanced Excel topics, and I cover a lot in a short amount of time, so be ready to pause and rewind as needed. First, let's insert a new column and call it CLR for color. Make it narrow, and then enter some letters to represent red, green, orange, blue, purple, cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. Now I'll create a relative named range for the color column. Go to Formulas, Name Manager, New. Call it Task underscore color. Choose Sheet 1 as the scope. Choose the cell in column C that is on the same row, then make the row number relative. The font color in the chart area is white, so I'll change it to black so that I can demonstrate how this relative named range works. Anytime we refer to task underscore color in a formula, it will return the value from column C. The next step is to create a new conditional formatting rule for each of the different colors. Select any cell in the chart area for now. One method would be to make new rules just like the purple one, adding an extra condition that checks the letter in the color column, but I'll show a different approach. I'm going to create a new rule that for now is just equal to true and does not apply any formatting at all. Then I'll copy the applies to range from the purple bar rule. When I apply the change, nothing happens yet, but now I'll check the stop if true box. When this rule is true, it stops any of the rules below it from being applied to the cells within the applies to range. Move the rule down to just above the purple rule and click apply. Now only the purple rule below it is blocked because rules are evaluated from top to bottom. Now I'll change the stop rule to only be true when the bars should not be highlighted. That may seem confusing at first, but it will simplify things later. First, I'll copy the formula for the purple bars. Then I'll edit the formula for the new rule and paste the formula inside the not function. And then I'll change the purple bar formula to equals true. I set this rule to true because it will be our default color. Now let's add the rule to make the bars red. All we need is the formula task underscore color equals R with R between double quotes. The R can be upper or lowercase. Now we move this rule down below our stop rule and above our default purple rule, and then copy and paste the applies to range. I'll move the window so you can see what happened. So now we just repeat this for all of the other colors. Notice that I'm using these colors instead of the theme colors. That is because theme colors can change if the theme is changed, and we want R to remain red and G to remain green. Red, orange, and yellow are good colors to use for indicating urgency, red being the most urgent and orange being the next most urgent. I'm adding a rule for choosing purple as a color, even though purple is our current default. By default, I mean the rule that is at the bottom and set to true, this one here. In theory, using this approach ought to be more efficient than repeating our complicated formula for every rule. To be even more efficient, we could check the stop if true box on all of these new color rules. The letter C is used for cyan. I like this one, but I think I'll choose a color with a bit more green in it. I would recommend choosing a set of colors that won't hurt people's eyes. For example, for magenta, we could choose this bright color, but I don't like how bright it is, so I'm going to choose a lighter shade instead. If you struggle to create color schemes that won't offend the artistic eye, I have one main tip for you. Choose a main color, and then for your other colors, just change the hue. I will demonstrate this in a minute when I change the default color. We will use K for black because B is already used for blue and K is commonly used for black. We don't have diamonds for milestones in our Gantt chart yet, but we can use a black color for milestones. Now I'll change the default color to brown. To demonstrate changing just the hue, I'll choose this purple as my base color, then go to More Colors, choose HSL from the Color Model dropdown, and enter 22 for brown. You can make some decent color schemes by just changing the hue. you want to choose the colors manually for each task, it may be helpful to create a drop-down list. Go to Data Validation, choose List, and enter the color codes separated by commas. This will help you remember what colors are available. One way to use color coding is to assign colors by the name of the assigned lead. Start by going to the Settings worksheet and creating a table for listing the names in their color codes. Nothing complicated here, so I'll do this quickly. Now I'm going to select the table and use the name box to name it lead_table. For the drop-down list in the lead column, I'm going to be fancy and use the index function to return the first column of the lead table by leaving the second argument blank, which is normally the row number. I'll enter a few names in the lead column now. The formula in the color column is going to be a VLOOKUP function with cell B8 as the lookup value. We'll use IFError to handle blanks or when the name isn't listed in our table and have it show a dash. Now just copy the formula down and it's done. Now these bars are color-coded by the name in the lead column and everything else uses the default color. Another useful feature to include in a Gantt chart is to highlight overdue tasks. One way to do that is to edit the formula in the color column. If task end is less than today and task progress is less than 1, then return an R. Otherwise, we'll use the original formula. Now copy that down. This method requires a formula to be in the color column, so let's undo that and use a conditional formatting rule instead. This time, select the upper left cell in the range. Then go to Manage Rules and create a new rule. The formula will use AND to test two conditions. Task progress is less than 1, and today is greater than or equal to this cell, making the column relative. Now we'll choose the fill color to be red. Move the rule directly under the stop rule, then copy and paste the applies to range. This is great, but let's make this feature something you can turn on and off. Go to the settings worksheet and add a label called Show Overdue. Then use a data validation list to choose between true or false. Now let's name this cell show_overdue in the name box. Now we'll edit the rule to include the new Show Overdue option. If you want to quickly turn this on and off, you can insert a checkbox form control. I'll update the label to Show Overdue. Then right-click on it and select Format Control. In the cell link field, type equals and the name ranged show_overdue. Now we have an easy way to turn it on and off. Another way to highlight overdue tasks is to highlight the date in the end column. Select the range and go to Conditional Formatting, New Rule. The formula for this one will be very similar to the others, but we'll also include the Show Overdue option. Remember, we always write the rule based on the upper left cell in the range, so the last condition is F8 is less than or equal to today. For this, we'll change the fill color to light red and set the font color to a darker red. Now we have a color-coded Gantt chart and a way to highlight overdue tasks. I want to end with a warning about conditional formatting in Excel. Let's say I want to insert a bunch of rows by copying and pasting this group of rows. I can right-click where I want to insert them and select Insert Copied Rows. But if I look at all the conditional formatting rules in the worksheet now, you'll see that I have just nearly doubled the number of rules. Excel split the applies to ranges rather than merging them. Another way this can happen is if you insert new rows and then use copy and paste. You won't notice a problem with these split rules until you want to change a rule, or when you have so many that Excel slows down or even crashes. I'm going to undo what I just did and show two ways of avoiding this problem. First, after inserting new rows, the formatting is already copied, and to fill down, just select the previous row and use the drag handle. For the second method, after copying a set of rows, right-click where you want to paste and go to Paste Special. Then select the All Merging Conditional Formats option. To vote on the suggestion that merged rules should be the default behavior in Excel, see the link in the description. That's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Remember to like it and comment to let me know what else you might like to see. If you want to download the files I've made in this video series, they are available with the Pro version. See the link in the description. Thanks for watching.